In this video, we'll explore the relationship and potential conflicts between policy objectives related to unemployment, inflation, economic growth, exchange rates, the balance of payments, and the redistribution of income and wealth. As we look at each potential conflict, I'll discuss the issues involved and then raise further points to consider. First up is a conflict between inflation and unemployment. Contractionary fiscal and monetary policies used to reduce demand pull inflation may cause a rise in unemployment. The fall in aggregate demand will reduce output and employment and potentially inflation. Expansionary policies aimed at promoting economic growth may decrease unemployment by boosting output and real GDP, but then increase inflation. With that said, however, we need to consider the following. First, the government could use supply-side policies to increase economic growth, to lower unemployment, and lower the price level. The second thing we need to think about is that if there is significant spare capacity in an economy, expansionary policies may have little impact on inflation. There tends to be a close relationship between inflation and economic growth. Expansionary fiscal and monetary policies may boost aggregate demand and increase real GDP, but also lead to a rise in demand pull inflation. Contractionary policies that reduce aggregate demand can be successful in reducing inflation, but at the expense of economic growth. So inflation will fall, but economic growth will fall as well. So once again, it's important to consider this. Supply-side policies can increase productive capacity, which can generate economic growth without inflationary pressure. Also, as we mentioned before, the amount of inflationary pressure will depend on the level of spare capacity in the economy. When spare capacity is low, inflationary pressure will tend to be high. Third is the relationship between inflation and exchange rates. This one can be a little complicated, so you'll need to closely follow the chain of logic. Inflation can cause exports to be less price competitive globally, and thus lead to a fall in overseas demand for exports, which will reduce currency demand and possibly cause the currency to depreciate. Following a period of inflation, imports may also appear relatively cheaper to domestic buyers, and thus the supply of the currency will increase in foreign exchange markets, adding more to the downward pressure on its value. Do keep in mind, though, that the extent to which inflation impacts exchange rates depends on how much inflation changes and for how long. Also, how much inflation in other countries changes, and finally, how elastic the demand for exports and imports are. If inflation changes minimally and for a short period of time, it will not have as much of an impact on the exchange rate as a situation in which there is a significant and persistent increase in inflation. If other countries are also experiencing inflation, their relative rates will also influence the ultimate change in a country's trade and the resulting impact on its exchange rate. Also, if the demand for a country's products is highly inelastic, then the demand for the currency is likely to rise as more is needed to purchase goods and services. Countries operating fixed exchange rates in this situation may need to intervene to maintain the value of their currency. Fourth is the relationship between inflation and the redistribution of income and wealth. Unanticipated inflation will cause some wages and salaries to adjust more than the change in the price level, whereas others may see their salaries change by less. Borrowers will benefit from unexpected inflation, and lenders will likely lose. Borrowers will be repaying their debts with money that has lower purchasing power than the money they borrowed. If they have borrowed at a fixed rate of interest, unanticipated inflation will harm the lender. Individuals on fixed incomes are worse off in terms of real earnings and purchasing power. And once again, the extent of the impact of inflation depends on its magnitude and how long it continues for. Fifth is the relationship between unemployment and economic growth. Measures to promote economic growth will generally reduce unemployment. However, policies used to reduce economic growth, often with the aim of reducing inflation, will have the opposite effect. It's important to remember that the government pursues strategies to promote economic growth in large part to reduce unemployment. However, when it decides to restrain economic growth, it is often willing to accept a rise in unemployment. For example, monetary policy aimed at lowering inflation by decreasing the money supply can surely reduce output, but it will increase unemployment. Sixth is the relationship between unemployment and the balance of payments. As incomes rise and unemployment falls, import spending is likely to rise, pushing the current account towards a deficit. If unemployment persists and a country's labor force experiences a fall in productivity, exports will become less competitive globally. Also consider that the rise in import spending as unemployment falls may also be on capital, which can promote future economic growth. Falling unemployment can also lead to increased spending in general, which could eventually cause inflation and reduce the global price competitiveness of a country's exports. Seventh is the relationship between unemployment and the exchange rate. If the currency appreciates, it can cause exports to become relatively more expensive to foreign buyers and imports relatively cheaper to domestic buyers. This can cause job losses in the domestic exporting industry as firms attempt to reduce their costs. The overall impact can push the current account towards a deficit. Conversely, if a currency depreciates, it could stimulate export demand abroad and increase exports. This can reduce unemployment as jobs in export industries rise. Imports will also become relatively more expensive, and the overall impact can push the current account towards a surplus. Last up is the relationship between unemployment and the redistribution of income. Unemployment risks are generally highest amongst those with low incomes, as they are often lower skilled. Without unemployment benefits to support them, income inequality will be much worse. Do note, though, that if higher taxation and more generous state benefits are provided to limit the impact of unemployment, these policies may impact incentives as well. High income earners may be discouraged from earning more and working harder, and those receiving benefits may have less incentive to return to work. By now, you should have a much deeper understanding of the relationships and conflicts that exist as government pursues its macroeconomic policy. If you have any questions or comments, leave them below. That's us done for now, and I will see you in the next one.